Okay, we're back with Dr. Karin Huffer, Judicial System and Accessibility Legal Abuse Syndrome PTSD document, bottom of page 12 of 25. Overcoming distance and financial barriers faced by PTSD / LAS sufferers. Usual psychological assessments are accomplished by meeting with the client face-to-face and performing structured interviews, self-reporting checklists, and any other assessments that create an ideal review. I think it was supposed to be Anne. Then cues can be perceived from the client, rapport built, and a professional relationship established in the setting designed for the purpose. In the matters of cases like those listed above, an attitude of flexibility may have to adjust the usual and preferred patterns of assessment, diagnosis, and therapy. LAS and the traumatic stress that emanates from the experiences of the LAS victim usually render the client economically devastated and unable to travel or pay for psychological services. Congress responded to this need and the requirements of the ADA by passing the Balanced Budget Act, BBA of 1997. This opened the area of interest, counseling and assessment, as well as telephone contact, text contact, and the breadth of new technology was introduced into the delivery of mental health services. Access improved by distance services. Third-party insurance payment was given a boost by the federal government when telehealth and telemedicine was accepted as part of the Balanced Budget Act, BBA, that was introduced to Congress on March 3, 1997, Balanced Budget Act, 1997, according to the Federal Register, 1998, In Section 4206 of the Balanced Budget Act of 1997, the Congress required that not later than January 1, 1999, Medicare Part B pay for professional consultations by a physician via interactive telecommunications systems. Under Section 4206A of BBA, payment may be made under Medicare Part B, provided the teleconsultation service is furnished to a beneficiary who resides in a country in a rural area designated as a health profession shortage area, 5E, Federal Register 1998. This applies to United States law, but I'm sure there's reciprocal laws in Canada and other countries. This is a document from early 2000s or something like that, a lot's changed since then too. DSM-4 was recognized. Actually, I think they're on DSM-5 or 6 now. Anyway, the fee structure for telemedicine was broken down into 75% of the set fee would go to the professional doing the consultation, and the other 25% would be for the referring practitioner, Federal Register, 1998. The clinical social worker and the clinical psychologist would be eligible to collect the fee as the referring practitioner. For example, a clinical social worker in a health profession shortage area has a client who needs psychiatric services. The social worker could make a referral to a psychiatrist who has this technology and assist the client with accessing help. Psychiatry is a covered service under Medicare Part B, so both parties would be reimbursed Healthcare Financing Administration, 1999. Technology can greatly assist in reaching people who are unable to assess and access legal and mental health services in the customary ways. Legislation is referenced above is a giant step in causing private insurers to develop proper policies and add telehealth services to their covered benefits. 14 states have already expanded their Medicaid programs to include telehealth services. Telemedicine, telehealth, and technology in general has the potential for increasing access to quality health care, including mental health for all. Very simply, the telephone by itself is proving to be much overlooked and invaluable tool in assisting those who may otherwise not be able to receive the full range of mental health services or to make services more effective. Journal of the American Medical Association published the first major look at treating depression with a psychotherapy over the phone in August of 2004. Gregory Simon, the psychiatrist who led the research on 600 patients at Group Health Cooperative in Seattle, reports 80% of patients who received phone therapy along with the antidepressants said their depression was much improved 6 months later, compared with 55% of those who received the pills alone. The future of including telehealth technologies is promising when considering people who have suffered from severe negative stress and have withdrawn from vital interactions as a result. Telemedicine has the potential to improve the delivery of healthcare in the United States by bringing a vast variety of services such as mental health services to underserved communities. We're calling it telehealth here, right? Telemedicine report to Congress, 1997. These changes have given birth to new standards being set for use of technology and therapy. The International Society for Mental Health Online is an organization that is setting standards to mental health services delivered in the new telehealth context. The results of their case research suggest that online mental health services, while being traditional in many ways, will evolve into new and innovative forms that are very different than the familiar face-to-face approaches. Communicating electronically from one individual to another or to a group of individuals simultaneously, relying on the internet, computer monitors, and written language skills, rather than on one's eyes and ears and oral language, shift the rapport normally established in the clinician's office to a time-altered, less spontaneous method of interaction. There are clear disadvantages ranging from clinician observation to treatment, which in cases of traumatic stress may include techniques such as EMDR, which cannot be done unless one is face-to-face. On the other hand, advantages seem to free up the client, allowing clients to relate without certain restraints emanating from shame-based feelings. The biggest advantage is economical and geographic. Clients who have limited funds, conditions that keep them housebound or restricted, or who are in delicate legal situations that prevent them from utilizing local mental health services, are provided enhanced accessibility to legal and mental health services by these non-traditional methods. The client can also communicate with therapists at any time rather than wait for an appointed time. Special accessibility issues for PTSD LAS clients. Why isn't more action taken to pursue actions to prevent psychiatric injury caused or exacerbated by the legal system or compensate the injured for the damages? Why hasn't it been identified and dealt with as a public health crisis? The following common symptoms of PTSD/LAS illustrate the fact that the more a person qualifies to pursue a claim for personal injury for psychiatric injury by satisfying PTSD DSM-4 diagnostic criteria, the more they are emotionally unable to pursue a claim. When basic trust is violated, there is an overwhelming sense of betrayal and inability to trust anyone. I don't know that from personal experience. Trust is lost for professionals, for systems, or even those who are close to you. Emotional, physical, and mental exhaustion overwhelm any desire to take action in mobilizing the litigant. Huffer dramatizes how shame consumes a responsible and conscience-centered person, while the wrongdoer does not know shame and can thrive in the litigation milieu, leaving PTSD LAS sufferers in his wake. Fear of retaliation or consequences also play into LAS victims' ability to do something about the situation. They have usually been ambushed and then official powers mobilized against them. LAS sufferers live in a state of terror while being held as emotional hostages. Hostages rarely take action against their captors. Typically with LAS, this hostage stage eventually gives way to responsibility. The victim wants to take action to fix the system, improve society, and prevent a similar fate befalling others to follow. LAS sufferers typically have great empathy and are prone to identifying with other people's suffering. A sensitive person being in a helpless posture causes profound erosion of self-esteem, as the person does not want to be seen as disabled and fights to regain independence. Yeah, nail on the head or what? It's that thing for me wanting to help other people. Not lately, though. I'll go down to that with the update. Next tape or whatever. I may have to wait till tomorrow. We'll go on at this rate. Haven't had a good few days. Still getting assaulted. But hopefully this means things are changing. Never know. Anyway. Obsession then drives a desire to educate and perfect the system. Hang on. Might have to take a break a minute. Try and finish this page. We're on page 15 of 25. Just near the bottom, I think. Okay, so obsession then drives a desire to educate and perfect the system. A few imbalanced victims will succumb to revenge acts. However, most LAS sufferers focus on responsible actions. Regardless of positive intentions, they are usually limited by the economic burden of legal action, leaving LAS sufferers in most cases financially broke, emotionally and psychiatrically damaged, and with no effective way to pursue or protect their right to pursue happiness as promised in this nation, including Canada. There is emerging a growing population of walking wounded who have been cast out of dynamic life. They exist saving their legal papers and boxes and suitcases with the faint hope that someday someone, some agency, some court will care and listen and help them to attain justice. They are sentenced to lives of varying combinations of the following symptoms impairing all normal functionality. Hypervigilance feels like but is not paranoia. Exaggerated startle response, irritability, sudden angry or violent outbursts, flashbacks, nightmares, intrusive recollections, sleep disturbance, exhaustion and chronic fatigue, reactive depression, guilt, avoidance along with numbness, unable to relax, cannot laugh or cry or feel passion, physical symptoms, lowered immune system, overwhelming sense of injustice, strong desire to do something about it but blocked. That's the end of the bullet points. Complicating the above list of usual symptoms are the following when LAS exists. The prolonged chronic negative stress resulting from protracted litigation can lead to threat or loss of job, career, health, and livelihood, often also resulting in threat to marriage and family life. The families of litigants are the unseen victims of litigation. Symptoms of PTSD LAS are mental, emotional, and physical exhaustion along with reactive depression, which can lead to isolation and even suicide. Anxiety also goes off the scale when scale even leading to panic attacks. Excessive stress depresses the immune system. Intrusive thoughts and memories disrupting concentration, relaxation, sleep disturbances, nightmares. Terror is common when protective systems that taxpayers support and depend upon in the world becomes an invisible hotbed of terror. Avoidance and numbness is concurrent. All reminders are avoided. The sufferer becomes frozen in time, unable to have fond memories, plan for the future, or enjoy the present. Obsession takes over as LAS sufferer tries to regain control of their environment and may focus on reliving the hostage experience. Feelings of withdrawal and isolation are common. The person just wants to be left alone. Huffer describes it as having layers of cellophane wrapped around the person. You can see them. They might be present at an event physically, but their emotional scar tissue keeps them isolated. Person loses personality dynamics. Numbness reigns. They are unable to cry or laugh and feel like love has left them. You can cry, all right. Extreme stress. And it's actually, I recommend it. Your body tells you you got to cry. You should let it. It's not a happy time, but it certainly does a lot to relieve your stress on your body. Your body's way of telling you it's time to let go of the pain and just cry for yourself, cry for the world, cry for whatever you need to. A good pillow helps. Just don't push your face in it too hard. You might not want to take it out, if you know what I mean. We need to get together on this. And to hell with the people who are running this horse and pony show. Because we are exploited. But you can see my other takes about that. And when you see the update. Again, I hope you like and subscribe. And more than that, I hope that if you know somebody is going through something like this, try for a little bit more understanding. Try to use this as an appeal to advocate for them. Not let them go it alone. Maybe there'll be time for healing, but you got to get through this first, or at least have the sense that you're not alone in it. But that's the whole point, isolation. And that's why I believe the Canadian, based on my experience and the evidence, Canadian legal system relies on LAS in everything they do. Matter of fact, in my case, they've employed it as a strategic tactic. Which again leads to this is a war crime. And I would argue that the whole basis of workplace safety and insurance system is this is the birthplace of LAS as a continuing condition because, well, you be the judge. Go do some research into what's going on with workplace safety stuff. And in my case, again, the powers that be allowed this employer to operate illegally for 5 years while doubling his accident rate and did nothing to correct a basic situation of making sure that a worker safety rep was in place. And that continued for 5 years until after my accident, only because of the prominence I brought to it of keep making sure that this doesn't happen. And that was before all the PTSD set in because I was just doing the right thing. It ended up being the abiding thing, but anyway, everybody has their own personal experience, that's for sure. So that's another reason why you can't just paint us all with the same brush. All the research I've done, anyway. And again, this is for public consumption. I'm hoping even just with making this available for persons that can't read it, just listening to it, will give you some sort of, at least acknowledgement. Acknowledge that, excuse me, that none of your, that your feelings are not in your imagination. And it'll give you a different perspective of how these certain, not all caregivers, because again, 98%, but a majority of people in every field are good people. It's those 1 or 2% that have the mark of Cain, or however you want to do it. They think they're better than everybody else, or above everybody else, or privileged. They got divine providence. God allows them to do this. It's their God-given right, or whatever their fantasy is. That's got to end. It's time to get, you know, you get rid of those people, or, I mean, I don't mean get rid of them in the sense of like a Hitler kind of thing. I mean, do whatever it takes to help them to conform. Because it's really funny how 98 or 99% of us who all feel the same about how it should be done are marching to the beat of the drummer of 1% who don't give a crap about anything except for making money off our exploited asset. Anyway, I'm sure you can relate to what I'm talking to, especially if you happen to be a victim of this strategy. And I believe that they're doing it in the States, too. Anyway, definitely needs time for discussion, I believe. And I believe my case, or this case, I'm going to stop calling it my case because it's not my case, this case. Because I may be part of this case, I may be the focus of what happened here, but you know what? It's about everything and everyone. It's about how it's done, and I'm not here to convince anybody. I'm going to press play. And that's kind of damning because, again, if I'm full of crap, then how did I get here and why are we still here and why is the court doing what they're doing? I mean, it's highly suspect. You'll have to tune into my one that I'm going to do where I give you the update on what's happened. I have been forced to represent myself at 4 different hearings. And they keep canceling them because this brain injury guy keeps asking the right questions, making them very nervous. You know, but they, anyway, you'll find out. And exercising the full will and power of the court to play with me, just as predicted. But now the perfect understanding, now I've got a better understanding of exactly, because I've got the answers of some of the answers. And you'll be curious to see some of these answers too. And there will not be any misconception about what's going on here. Certainly, necessary for a judicial, full judicial review of the system, because Ms. Raybould, our attorney general, seems to think it's not her job. Maybe I'll frame that. Well, actually, I can't remember if it's in that video or not, but I think I'm going to make a separate video showing that. And my many attempts to contact Diane Verneil and Raj Saini and even Carla Quattro, the federal disability minister, all of which actively over the last year have deliberately obstructed my ability to even be heard before the Committee on Disability in Canada. Anyway, more on that. So, yeah, it definitely shows who they represent. I'm sure. That's my opinion. You guys make up your own minds. I mean, here we go. Anyway, sorry about that. That's the last part, but I hope. We're only 18 minutes, okay, and we're at the bottom of page 16. The person has become hypersensitized and now unwittingly and inappropriately perceives almost any remark as critical. For many, social life ceases and work becomes impossible. The overwhelming need to earn a living combined with the inability to work deepens the trauma. The literature in the 1990s opened the entire concept of traumatic stress, recognizing that prolonged negative stress creates symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder. The incidence of PTSD is much greater than first recognized in the 1960s. It is thought that 5% of males and 10% of females will develop PTSD in their lifetime, says the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, INCE. Nice. Literally, N-I-C-E. Nice. Economy is impacted by loss of ability to work, plan a career, have hope, inspiration, trust, and the response to PTSD of fight, flight, or freeze. Summary and conclusions. With the prevalence, this is at the top of page 17, okay, Summary and conclusions. With the prevalence of chronic complex trauma and the consistent reports of cases such as our cases A, B, and C, it is shocking how little research has been done on this population whose quality of life is preventably devastated by the insensitive, toxic, and unrelenting demands of the forensic experience. PTSD over the decades has been a misunderstood and slowly evolving concept as our society caught on that human beings do not experience battlefields, earthquakes, child abuse, and bullying, or prolonged litigation with no predisposed factors in play. Whether an attorney in practice who believes in representing clients in the spirit of attaining justice against the established brotherhood of attorneys who intimidate and frustrate, there's an asterisk there, I guess there's a footnote coming up, or a case of false arrest due to political power being able to distort our law enforcement and justice systems, twisting them into weapons to be used against persons targeted as a result of doing no wrong but knowing the wrong people. Each human being presents for mental health treatment or presents in the court for resolution with a unique emotional history. Rather than staying rigidly with the DSM-IV, which is merely a helpful guide to clinical practice open to dynamic change and dialogue, it would seem to be advisable to accept the concept of complex PTSD and err on the side of human service and sensitivity if one must err. The mental health professions exist as an inexact science, therefore leaning more on the goodwill effort to empirically measure as much as possible and then to abide by the Americans with Disabilities Act and our courts to ensure accessibility to all. Once accepted as a psychiatric injury, PTSD/LAS can be treated and accommodated by the court, allowing all those who use the courts of law to have a humane and manageable experience rather than the devastation of their lives. Attorneys also suffer compassion fatigue when they are helpless to affect the court toward promised justice. Quote, clearly, while the study of war, neurosis, motor vehicle accidents, hurricanes, and other non-interpersonal traumas has become respectable, investigating that darkest side of human nature, our capacity to horribly abuse and neglect our own offspring and intimates continues to rife with controversy. End quote. Van der Volk, 2001. V-A-N-D-E-R-K-O-L-K. Worse yet is the challenge of abuse of power differential between systems and the human beings they are intended to serve. Huffer is conducting continual longitudinal research that validates the experiences and symptoms above reported by attorneys and citizens who simply returned to their established systems for a right and reasonable resolution to a critical problem. They found that instead of help, they wound up with post-traumatic stress disorder of the legal abuse syndrome category, plus a host of other impairments to daily functioning that can only be described as colon. One, the person experienced or witnessed or was confronted with an event or events that involved actual or threatened death or serious injury or a threat to physical integrity of self or others. Two, the person's response involved intense fear, helplessness, or horror, DSM-IV, 1994. Or some just called it cruel and unusual punishment. Now the asterisk has a footnote here. It says, statistics regarding the health consequences of being an attorney suggest that the milieu in and around the court system is toxic. According to the Journal of Occupational Medicine, attorneys in the United States suffer depression at a rate of 3.6 times the national average. A 1991 John Hopkins University study of depression in 105 professions ranks attorneys first among all professions in the incidence and prevalence of clinical depression. According to other published studies, as many as 20% of all practicing attorneys experience clinical depression in any given year. Drinking problems correlated with length of practice. 18% of problem drinkers were found in those who had practiced 2 to 20 years. 25% in those who had practiced more than 20 years. That's alarming. I mean, again, good people trying to do the right thing. And we got this system that's supposed to be assisting us doing the opposite. It's the system. It's the framework. When are you going to get that? It's the framework and this other thing of privilege, because that's the basis of the Western democratic framework. Whether you're British, Canadian, American, these people are given privilege, and privilege is supposed to be something that they should be looking to a higher standard for and holding them to a higher standard, but apparently it's not. And it's not just my opinion. Anyway, it's followed up. Again, we're on the page of 18 of 25. We're in recommended readings and citations. So I'm going to do these one at a time, and clearly as I can. We got through this. We're coming up on 24 minutes for part B, so it looks like we're going to get in the, under the hour, which would be good if I can't keep, if I can't stop, or as long as I can stop babbling, I guess. Anyway, recommended readings and citations: American Psychiatric Association, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 4th edition, revised, which is the DSM-4 hyphen R, APA, Washington, D.C., 1994. Baker, B-A-K-E-R, comma, Claudia, C-L-A-U-D-I-A, M-S-W, M-P-H, and Alonzo, comma, which would be A-L-O-N-S-O, comma, Sessi, C-E-S-S-I-E, L-S-C-W, or L-C-S-W, and it's called Forensic Validity of a PTSD Diagnosis, Department of Veterans Affairs, National Center for PTSD. Barack, A, and Buchanan, T, 2004. Barack is B-A-R-A-K, comma, A, and Buchanan, B-U-C-H-A-N-A-N, T, 2004. Internet-based physiological testing and assessment. In R. Krause, J. Zach, and G. Stricker editions, Online Counseling, a Handbook for Mental Health Professionals, pp. 217 to 239, San Diego, comma, California, colon, Elsevier Academic Press, which is E-L-S-E-V-I-E-R, Academic Press. It said in R. Krause, which is K-R-A-U-S, and J. Zack, Z-A-C-K, and G. Stricker is S-T-R-I-C-K-E-R edition. And then it said in, I guess it's editions, which would be parentheses E-D-S, period, parentheses. Okay, so then there's Barack, A, and English, N, 2002, Prospects and Limitations of Psychological Testing on the Internet, Journal of Technology and Human Services, 19, parentheses 2, backslash 3, and parentheses, comma, 65 to 89. And Barack is B-A-R-A-K, comma, A, and English, E-N-G-L-I-S-H, comma, N, 2002. Next one is Bard, Morton, and Don Sangre. The the Crime Victims Book, publisher New York, Brunner Mazel, B-R-U-N-N-E-R, backslash M-A-Z-E-L, Inc., 1986. Bard, Morton, and Don Sangre is spelled B-A-R-D, comma, M-O-R-T-O-N, and Don, D-A-W-N, Sangre, S-A-N-G-R-E-Y. Next is Bremner, J.D., Narayan, M., 1998. The Effects of Stress on Memory and the Hippocampus Through the Life Cycle, Implications for Childhood Development and Aging, Developed Psychopath, 10, colon, 871 to 886. Bremner, J.D., Narayan, M., 1998, is spelled B-R-E-M-N-E-R-J-D, comma, and Narayan M is N-A-R-A-Y-A-N M. Obviously the last name, right? Bremner and Narayan. Next. next caption is Brown, James T, B-R-O-W-N, comma, James T, entitled Avoiding Litigation Neurosis, A Practitioner's Guide to Defending Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder Claims, the American Journal of Trial Advocacy, Volume 20, Number 1, Center for Advocacy and Clinical Education, Cumberland School of Law, Samford University, S-A-M-F-O-R-D, Birmingham, Alabama, Fall 1996. Next one. Goleman, Daniel, G-O-L-E-M-A-N, comma, Daniel, D-A-N-I-E-L. Entitled, Key to Post-Traumatic Stress Lies in Brain Chemistry, Scientist Finds. New York Times, 12th of June, 1990. Herman, Judith L., Trauma and Recovery, New York Basic Books, 1997. That's H-E-R-M-A-N, and Judith L. is her first and middle initial. First name, middle initial, J-U-D-I-T-H, and an L. Next one is Huffer, Karin, M.S., M.F.T., H-U-F-F-E-R, K-A-R-I-N. Overcoming the Devastation of Legal Abuse Syndrome. Full Court Press, Las Vegas, Nevada, 1995, pp. 20-26 and 69-77. Herder, Alex J., H-U-R-D-E-R, comma, Alex J., A-L-E-X-J, entitled ABA Urges Equal Access to Courts for Individuals with Disabilities, September/October 2002, 26:5, MPDLR, the International Society for Mental Health Online. Johnson, Jonies, PSYD, so psychological, I don't know what that is, anyway. Johnston, J-O-H-N-S-T-O-N, comma, Joni, J-O-N-I. And her her letters are PSY, period D, period. Shrink Wrap Investigating PTSD and Psychological Injury Claim, Lexis 1. A reporter for Oklahoma newspaper, March 28, 2005, by Sally Allen, anti-news editor, newsok.com. Next one is Neustein, Amy, and Lesher, Michael. That's N-E-U-S-T-E-I-N, comma, A-M-Y, and Lesher, L-E-S-H-E-R, comma, Michael. From Madness to Mutiny, the Northeastern University Press, Boston, Massachusetts, 2005. And it says, Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers, an Updated Guide to Stress, Stress-Related Diseases, and Coping, Robert M. Sapolsky, which is Robert, R-O-B-E-R-T, M, of course, is M, and Sapolsky is S-A-P-O-L-S-K-Y, Freeman Press, 1998, ISBN number 0-7167-3210-6. I don't know if it's Scare or Sayre. I would probably err on Sayre. S-C-A-E-R, comma, Robert, R-O-B-E-R-T, C-M-D. The Body Bears the Burden. Trauma, Disassociation, and Disease, the Haworth Medical Press, New York, 2001. Kinchin, this is the next one, Kinchin, David, K-I-N-C-H-I-N, David, D-A-V-I-D, entitled Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, The Invisible Injury, 2001 edition, Success Unlimited, UK, 2001. European Journal of Work and Organizational Psychology, EJWOP, 1996, 5(2). Whole issue devoted to bullying and its effects, including PTSD, published by Psychology Press, 27 Church Road, Hove, H-O-V-E, East Sussex, BN32FA in the UK. Next one is O'Brien, Dr. John T, O, apostrophe B-R-I-E-N, Dr. John T, MRCP, or MRC Psych, British Journal of Psychiatry, the Glucocorticoid Cascade Hypothesis in Man. Prolonged stress may cause permanent brain damage. Department of Psychiatry and Institute for Health of the Elderly, University of Newcastle, 1997, 170, 199-201. Next one is Tuttle, David, Cortisol. Oh, sorry. Tuttle, David, T-U-T-T-L-E, comma, David, D-A-V-I-D. And it's called Cortisol, Keeping a Dangerous Hormone in Check, LE Magazine, July 2004. Keen, T.M., P.F. Malloy, and J.A. Fairbank. So K-E-A-N-E, T.M. And there's P.F. Malloy, M-A-L-L-O-Y, and J.A. Fairbank, F-A-I-R-B-A-N-K. Entitled Empirical Development of MMPI Subscale for the Assessment of Combat-Related Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, Journal of Consulting and Clinical Psychology, page 52 and 888-891. Next one is Nadel, L, and Jacobs, W-J, N-A-D-E-L, comma, L, and Jacobs, J-A-C-O-B-S, comma, W-J, entitled The Role of Hippocampus in PTSD, Panic and Phobia, in Nobamasakato edition, Hippocampus Functions and Clinical Relevance, Amsterdam, Elsevier, 1996. So Nobamasakato edition is N-O-B-U-M-A-S-A and then Kato or Kato, K-A-T-O edition. And that was the Hippocampus Functions and Clinical Relevance, Amsterdam Elsevier, publisher, E-L-S-E-V-I-E-R, 1996. Next one is Rees, James Horn and Christine Dunning, R-E-E-S-E, James, J-A-M-E-S. Then James Horn, H-O-R-N, and Christine Dunning, C-H-R-I-S-T-I-N-E-D-U-N-N-I-N-G. Entitled Critical Incidents in Policing, Washington, D.C., U.S. Department of Justice, 1991. Next one is Pert, Candace, Ph.D. Pert being P-E-R-T, Candace, K-A-N-D-A-C-E, Ph.D. Molecules of Emotion is what it's entitled. New York, Scribner Books, S-C-R-I-B-N-E-R, 1999. Celia Hans, S-E-L-Y-E, comma, Hans is H-A-N-S. And again, I for some of these names, I hope I'm pronouncing them right. I'm trying to do it with respect, so hopefully you feel respected. The Stress of Life is what it's called. New York publisher McGraw-Hill, Inc., in 1956. Vanderkolk, Bessel, M.D., Yehuda Rachel, edition. Oh, okay, so Yehuda Rachel. Okay, so Vanderkolk is V, capital V-A-N, space, lowercase D-E-R, space, capital K-O-L-K, comma, and Bessel is B-E-S-S-E-L, and M.D. Then the other one is Yehuda. Rochelle Yehuda, so Yehuda would be Y-E-H-U-D-A, and Rochelle, or Rachel, I'm not sure which way she prefers to have it, R-A-C-H-E-L. The addition is The Assessment and Treatment of Complex PTSD, Chapter 7, Traumatic Stress, American Psychiatric Press, 2001. Next one is Vanderkolk Bessel, In the Eye of the Storm, The Psychotherapy Networker, January-February 2004, pp. 45 and 66. So Vanderkolk again, Bessel, same as New York. Another paper, it looks like a paper, Vanderkolk, Bessel, A, Alexander, C, McFarlane, and Lars Weiseth. Okay, so Vanderkolk, V-A-N, space D-E-R, capital K-O-L-K. Bessel is B-E-S-S-E-L, and his middle initial must be A. Next one is Alexander C. McFarlane, A-L-E-X-A-N-D-E-R, middle initial C. McFarlane, M-C, big F-A-R-L-A-N, and Lars Weiseth, or Weiseth, I guess. Again, I hope I got it right. L-A-R-S is his first name, and Weiseth, or Weiseth, is W-E-I-S-E-L. A-E-T-H, or it could be Weiseth. Weiseth, anyway, be curious to find out. Editions is Traumatic Stress, New York, Guildford, G-U-I-L-D-F-O-R-D, 1996. And then last one for this list is Zegan, Z or Z, G-E-A-N, comma LS, and it's entitled Handbook of Stress, Theoretical and Clinical Aspects, ED, Goldberger and Bresnitz, G-O-L-D-B-E-R-G-E-R, and Bresnitz, B-R-E-Z-N-I-T-Z, New York Free Press, 1982. Then they have internet resources, www.bazelon.org, which is B-A-Z-E-L-O-N.org. Next one is http://, www.giftfromwithin.org, /HTML/counting.html. www.traumacenter.org, www.legalabusesyndrome.org, or www.legalabusesyndrome.com, Healthcare Financing Administration, 1999. http://, www.cms.whs.gov/medicaid/default.asp, question mark. And the next one is http, backslash, well, there's a colon after HTTP, by the way, backslash, www.ismho.org, / a nonprofit organization formed in 1997 to promote the understanding, use, and development of online communication, information, and technology for the international mental health community. Internet Mental Health, www.mentalhealth.com, copyright 1995-2005 by Philip W. Long, M.D. That's P-H-I-L-L-I-P, W. Long is L-O-N-G, M-D. Okay. Essentials for Litigating Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, PTSD Claims, http://, www.lawandpsychiatry.com/HTML/ litigating percent. Sign 20, capital PTSD, percent sign 20, claims, that's capital C-A-L-A-I-M-S, percent 20 hyphen percent 20 final, at capital F-I-N-A-L dot PDF. And HTTP colon / www.va.gov / HTTP colon / home.earthlink.net / I don't know what that sign is. There's like a wavy thing. Hopeful, H-O-P-E-F-U-L-L / trauma.htm. Again, I'm not sure if these links are still active because this, I think this was 2005, 2006, this document, but it's definitely at the start of it all. HTTP colon / www.welcome, W-E-L-L-C-O-M-E dot A-C dot U-K / E-N / genome, G-E-N-O-M-E / tackling disease / H-G-1-2-B 004.html. The National Institute for Clinical Excellence, which is NICE, N-I-C-E, literally, makes national recommendations on best practice in medical treatment and care with the aim of ensuring an equal and effective service across the National Health Service in England and Wales. Wow, that, we need something like that here, don't we? And the last one here is Gillian Kelly, G-I-L-L-I-A-N, Kelly, K-E-L-L-Y, barrister at law, looks at the development of post-traumatic stress disorder and the legal recognition thereof on her website at http colon / / www.telecoms.net / law / index.html. As a recognized psychiatric illness, the condition has been demonstrated in the course of the past 140 years to be as worthy of compensation law as any physical injury inflicted through negligence. Then they have appendix one. We're at 43 right now. What page are we at? 21 or 25. So you got four more left, so I guess that's the appendixes. I'm gonna take a quick break. I'll be right back. Okay, we're almost done. I'm just gonna push through to the end. I hope I'm not gonna be, hopefully image stabilization works on this thing, eh? Because I got anyway, can't help that. It's been kind of stressful, so yeah, I'm kind of still in the reactionary mode, and that's like from almost a week ago. Anyway, it's not pleasant. Not in any way, shape, or form. As many of you probably know if you're looking at this, because it's really funny that nobody in Canada is godless, apparently. Differences between appendix one, and this is at bottom of page 21. So appendix one, differences between mental illness and psychiatric injury. Kinchin, K-I-N-C-H-I-N, 2001, has illustrated clearly how a psychiatric injury is different from mental illness. It is done in the context of employment bullying, but if considered in light of complex PTSD and the official bullying that exists in legal abuse syndrome, it can help clarify for the litigant in court the differences. The first graphic shows the difference between paranoia and hypervigilance, and the second graphic illustrates psychiatric injury versus mental illness. So again, first graphic shows the difference between paranoia and hypervigilance, and then the second one illustrates psychiatric injury versus mental illness. So, paranoia is a form of mental illness. The cause is thought to be internal. Hypervigilance is a response to an external event, violent. Oh, sorry, I guess this is on the other page too, so I didn't finish. They're in boxes or whatever, so. Sorry, paranoia is a form of mental illness. The cause is thought to be internal. For example, a minor variation in the balance of brain chemistry. Whereas hypervigilance is a response to an external event, violence, accident, disaster, violation, intrusion, bullying, etc., and therefore an injury. Paranoia tends to endure and not to get better of its own accord, whereas hypervigilance wears off, gets better, albeit slowly, when the person is out of and away from the situation which was the cause. Paranoiac will not admit to feeling paranoid as they cannot see their paranoia. The hypervigilant person is acutely aware of their hypervigilance and will easily articulate their fear, albeit using the incorrect but popularized word paranoia. I don't use the word paranoia. Anxiety, maybe. It's not paranoia. It's paranoia when it's not real. This is real. You guys are paranoid. You need to listen to my tapes and then you can fix that paranoia real quick. Sometimes responds to drug treatment for paranoia, whereas with hypervigilance, drugs are not viewed favorably by hypervigilant people except in extreme circumstances and then only briefly. Often drugs have no effect or can make things worse, sometimes interfering with the body's own healing process. Paranoia. The paranoiac often has delusions of grandeur. The delusions aspects of paranoia feature in other forms of mental illness such as schizophrenia. Whereas the hypervigilant person often has a diminished sense of self-worth, sometimes dramatically so. Where the paranoiac is convinced of their self-importance, the hypervigilant person is often convinced of their worthlessness and will often deny their value to others. Paranoia is often seen in conjunction with other symptoms of mental illness, but not in conjunction with symptoms of PTSD. Hypervigilance is seen in conjunction with other symptoms of PTSD, but not in conjunction with symptoms of mental illness. The paranoiac is convinced of their plausibility, whereas the hypervigilant person is aware of how implausible their experience sounds and often doesn't want to believe it themselves, disbelief and denial. You know, the other thing too is because you can't, how are they getting away with this? Like, all the rhetoric out there and this is the reality. Just keep pretending everything's okay. It's much better that way, isn't it? For you. The paranoiac feels persecuted by a person or persons unknown. For example, they're out to get me. Whereas the hypervigilant person is hypersensitized, but is often aware of the inappropriateness of their heightened sensitivity and can identify the person responsible for the psychiatric injury. Sense of persecution with paranoia, and where hypervigilant, it's a heightened sense of vulnerability to victimization. That is true. In paranoia, the sense of persecution felt by the paranoiac is a delusion, for usually no one is out to get them. Whereas the hypervigilant person's sense of threat is well-founded, for the serial bully is out to get rid of them and has often coerced others into assisting, either through mobbing. Hypervigilant person often cannot and refuses to see that the serial bullying is doing everything possible to get rid of them. Oh, I see it all right. They refuse to see it. I guess they're paranoid. They see, anyway, I don't want to get into that. The paranoiac is on a constant alert because they know someone is out to get them, whereas a hypervigilant person is on alert in case there is danger. The paranoiac is certain of their belief and their behavior and aspects, or expects others to share that certainty, whereas the hypervigilant person cannot bring themselves to believe that the bully cannot and will not see the effect their behavior is having. They cling naively to the mistaken belief that the bully will recognize the wrongdoing and apologize. Oh, I have no illusions about that. Government of Canada apologizing for anything? Yeah, go ask the natives how they felt about that one, eh? Yeah, we're sorry you did that, but hey, turn the corner, we'll do it again. Habit of this colonial imperialistic nature. More videos coming out on that soon. We actually have a solution, a few solutions. Well, proposals, I guess you'd call them. Maybe the formation of the groundwork, laying the groundwork for the, what do they call that? Manifesto for a brand new program. We're going to call it the new program. You know, they always keep saying, get with the program. Well, I'm not with that program. I don't think a lot of you people are with that program either. Sort of like, who are they? Anyway, we'll get back to this. More to come. Interesting. At the very least, it should be entertaining. So if I make it, still a real possibility that I might be murdered by the police. They're really stubborn. They just don't want to, they don't even want to look at what I've got on them because they know if they do, they got to do something about it. Anyway, watch the tape. It's going to be coming soon. And it's jam-packed full of information about exactly what's been going on here because we are well-informed and we're about to inform you. And by the way, I'm sending this to all those players that I sent to before from government. So you've got one last chance, people. Well, actually, your chance is over, but you can make it a little better. Because the secret's out. And it's going to be out. And I'm glad it's out. Because you know what? Anything I can do to stop you people from doing this to anybody else again? Hey, like it says in here, I've got a high sense of purpose. And I don't mind. Not in the least. Okay, so the next one is, other differences between mental illness and psychiatric injury include, with mental illness, the cause often cannot be identified, whereas psychiatric injury, the cause is easily identifiable and verifiable, but denied by those who are accountable. These people are on the ball, aren't they? In mental illness, the person may be incoherent or what they say doesn't make sense, whereas the person is often articulate but prevented from articulation by being traumatized. In mental illness, the person may appear to be obsessed, whereas psychiatric injury, the person is obsessive, especially in relation to identifying the cause of their injury and both dealing with the cause and affecting the recovery. Mental illness, a person is oblivious to their behavior and the effect it has on others, whereas psychiatric injury, the person is in a state of acute self-awareness and aware of their state, but often unable to explain it. Mental illness, the depression is a clinical or an endogenous depression, or endogenous, something like that. Whereas with psychiatric injury, the depression is reactive. The chemistry is different to endogenous depression, whatever that is. In mental health, there may be a history of depression in the family. Whereas in psychiatric injury, there is very often no history of depression in the individual or their family. Mental illness, the person has usually exhibited mental health problems before. And in psychiatric injury, often there is no history of mental health problems. And mental health may respond inappropriately to the needs and concerns of others. Psychiatric industry, or mental illness was the other one. Psychiatric industry responds to the needs and concerns of others despite their own injury. Oh, yeah, that's true. It's a pleasant distraction, if you want to call that pleasant. Well, it is better to focus on somebody else's pain when you can't do anything about your own. It's anyway. Mental illness displays a certitude about themselves, their circumstances, and their actions, whereas psychiatric injury is often highly skeptical about their condition and circumstances and is in a state of disbelief and bewilderment, which they will easily and often articulate, I can't believe this is happening and why me? Yeah, especially the last few weeks. Mental illness may suffer a persecution complex, whereas psychiatrically injured may experience an unusually heightened sense of vulnerability to possible victimization, for example, hypervigilance. Mental illness, suicidal thoughts are a result of despair, dejection, and hopelessness. Whereas in psychiatric injury, suicidal thoughts are often a logical and carefully thought out solution or conclusion. Yeah, that's right. Mental illness exhibits despair, whereas psychiatric injury is driven by the anger of injustice. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. What is that? Oh, Henry or something? Huh. Oh, hey, you guys owe me money, don't you? Oh, Henry's got nuts. Yeah, I'm supposed to be nuts. Anyway. That's gay. Take my portion and give it the... Actually, I would like it to go towards PTSD LAS research and bringing out public awareness on this. Because you know what? The more the public is aware of this, the less the courts can do it. And those in positions of power, such as Waterloo Regional Police Services, I've offered to... Anyway, I'll do the update. Or updates. Probably do more than one. Okay, so mental illness often doesn't look forward to each new day, whereas psychiatric injury looks forward to each new day as an opportunity to fight for justice. Mental illness is often ready to give in or admit defeat, whereas psychiatric injury refuses to be beaten, refuses to give up. Yeah. I was comparing myself to, if you've ever seen, Monty Python, The Holy Grail. You know the part where the knight's having the fight and he gets his arm cut off and he's bleeding. Oh, come back here. Oh, you've still got one arm and two legs left. And they cut off the other arm and he's like, well, come back here. I'll kick you to death. Cuts off another leg and hopping on one leg, he's like, come on, you coward. And all of a sudden they cut off his other leg and he's a torso going, come back over here and I'll bite you. Well, that's me. That's me. So until you cut the head off, I'd still be rolling around doing the Flip Wilson thing. Gee, I should have quit while I was ahead. You know, and actually, look that up online. Flip Wilson was a comedian in the 60s and 70s. Amazing. Had his own television show, too. And Black History, man. You're talking another trendsetter that's not talked about very often. I don't know why. Very funny man. You know, and again, shut up about this color crap, okay? We're all human. All human beings. So the rest of us human beings have to learn to get along with the other human beings. Whichever side you're on. Anyway, 57 minutes. So that's that book. And there's also links to other things there, but that's that publication. So that I'm going to send a copy of that. I'm going to put the link on it. And when I'm done, I'm sending a link to the people that I've sent it to before, especially Ms. Raybould and the Attorney Generals and the Prime Minister and the Premier and all those people get another funny mailing out from me. You know, it's interesting too, because I'm pretty sure Diane Verneil, who is the MPP for Kitchener, she used to work for CTV, and it's really funny how a lot of these CTV characters end up getting into politics, eh? And CTV's doing the media campaign, Belltel Global Media campaign of let's talk about mental health, eh? Well, they really don't want to. That is all that propaganda crap to scare the shit out of you people. That's why it's important to put the truth on the internet like this and make up your minds for yourself. Anyway, it's interesting because I'm pretty sure, you see, Diane Verneil used to work for CTV. She used to do a show called Province Wide, which was an investigative journalism kind of thing. And I'm pretty darn sure that even I, she was also a journalist for CKCO for a few years there too or something. So I'm pretty sure that, I have to do research in this, but if anybody could help me, didn't Province Wide do a special on Westray coal mine disaster? One other thing, I just want to read something else. I'm going to put it at the head of the other one, but I came across this thing about, it's a quote. It's from a document called Legal Abuse Syndrome, Utilizing a Tort Action in Family Law Cases. On Panama Publishing, Inc. Pro Se Self-Help Guidebook Series. So I guess pro se is you're probably self-represented. So it's Panama Publishing, Inc., which is www.panama-publishing.com. It's called Legal Abuse Syndrome Utilizing a Tort Action in Family Law Cases. Copyright 2011, Panama Publishing, Inc., all rights reserved. And again, I'm doing this for fair use, so if you need to say something to me, go ahead, please. I'm probably, anyway, and just let people know. It's on, and again, I'm writing it, this is off of Scribd, S-C-R-I-B-D, period, which is another one of these sites. It's available at www.scribd.com/document/14533010/ebook-legal-abuse-syndrome-pdf. And that's ebook-legal-abuse-syndrome-pdf. And it says, first edition, well, it says, all rights reserved. No part of this book may be used or reproduced in any manner whatsoever without written permission, except in the case of brief quotations used in articles and reviews. Well, hey, I guess I got covered then, eh? First edition, October 2011. So, Books by Panama Publishing, Inc. is pro se self-help guidebook series. Winning strategies and tactics for use in a family law court. How to modify your alimony payments. How to lower your alimony payments. Tips and techniques. How to defend yourself in contempt of court hearings. How to appeal in state court of appeals. Jail, an inmate survival guide. The above books are available at our website at www.panama-publishing.com. And so, now I get to do the quote, I guess, because I you know, it's important to promote, you know, and help each other. So I appreciate the fact that this is here, and I'm letting other people know. So this is the quote, and it's very pertinent. It's by Carl von Clausewitz, or Weitz, whatever. CarlVonClausewitz. And what he said is this: what do we mean by defeat of the enemy? Simply the destruction of his forces, whether by death, injury, or any other means, either completely or enough to make him stop fighting. The complete or partial destruction of the enemy must be regarded as the sole object of all engagements. Direct annihilation of the enemy's forces must always be the dominant consideration. That is Workplace Safety and Insurance Board. That is my experience throughout this whole so-called human rights legal experience. Anyway, gonna be interesting. So I will leave you with that, and I will start my, you see, because the update, that's very, you're gonna see how pertinent that is for the update. Anyway, thank you very much. I hope everybody's remaining safe out there. Try and keep heartened. It's been a tough road for me. Not done yet by a long shot. Not sure how much time I got left. Depends on, you know, whether or not they're gonna let me live. I'm really a threat. Like I said, this is not only, now that this is coming around like this, I would even predict that this is the biggest human rights case in the history of the world. Well, I am ever. I must be somebody else, I guess. No, I'm not saying that for grandiosity or anything like that. I'm just saying, if anybody ever got the chance to actually review this, and again, this is not about I made this up or I made that up. Again, we're talking about, and I didn't realize the significance of it. I was so wrapped up in everything else. But what we're talking about here is, well, 2004 until present, this June 21st, it will be 13 years. It was probably about, I can't remember, it was maybe 6 months, within the first 6 months to a year before I even started recording, because I was recuperating and we weren't sure of the memory problems yet. It hadn't been determined, but, and then, I started doing it. Actually, I believe the first time I recorded was the first day my nurse case manager came online. And I'm pretty sure it's the first conversation I recorded was the one that I had with her that day. When I came home from the AIM clinic, was allowed to come home from the AIM clinic when I was diagnosed as not oriented to person, place, or time and fluctuating vital signs. And that was basically Kevin Kelly from AIM stated that it was because the nurse case manager, Susan Sefton, instructed him to do that, which is non-medical person, a nurse is not allowed to direct treatment. And this was recommended by my doctor, which means he was supposed to report to my doctor. And at the very least, any information that nurse was given was to be communicated to my doctor, because it was initiated before WSIB even got involved. And from the moment they got involved, it was nothing but deliberate obstruction and interference. And it is documented. There is no way that you cannot come up with that conclusion once you see all this evidence in its entirety, especially with what happened at WSIB. This thing called legal abuse syndrome, I am saying there's a new one called medical abuse syndrome, if it's based on this. Anyway, more about that later. This is not right to do to anybody on any terms. So let's do something about it, shall we? I guess we'll have to wait and see. Anyway, hope this finds everybody well. And keep up the good fight. You know, one day at a time. There is a God up there. After I tell you what happened to me, this has been against all odds, but hey. Anyway, you'll see. There's a lot of bad here, but I hope it brings inspiration and maybe even pick you up again. The thing is sometimes you just got to keep plodding forward. Use the routine as a distraction. I highly recommend it. Again, it worked for me. I'm not sure if it worked for anybody else. It's kind of hard to wrap your mind around, I know, probably. But what I really highly recommend is seek out a place like Ray of Hope or Soup Kitchen. Volunteer. Or even just go down there and hang out and get to know people. And you don't have to develop friendships, although I'm pretty sure you will. You know, surprise the hell out of you, probably, if you let yourself open to it. But open yourself up to what is actually happening. Because everybody, when it comes, I don't know, like pretty much, I can speak for Canada because I'm here. In Canada, it's about the business of medicine, the business of law, the business of poverty. And matter of fact, the biggest thing that we found out in Canada is that all disability representation, majority of it is for policy decision makers, guiding policy. They do not do individuals. Majority of the rest that are actually practicing law is where the money is, which is accidents, vehicle accidents and other litigation like that. That's why it's a closed system. There is not even allowed to be a question, let alone an inference of anything. Where it crosses, I mean, they think that everything fits into a little box. Sorry, I can't do it. A little box like this. That they can just make it all fit right there. And if it doesn't fit, well, we'll just cut away the other stuff. And usually that's the stuff that has to do with why we're here in the first place. Reading this, you know, I have been really bad lately as far as getting down and stuff. But, you know, we found this yesterday. And just to start reading it, and to have, you know, there's reports you read where it's like you'll hit a beat here, a beat there, where it's like, oh, that's okay, that's related, and this and that, and there's a little stuff here. In my relating my experience to people, and especially when I put up the next one, if I know where we are now, I think you'll see that